Blackstone Audio and Skyboat Media present Women Destroy Science Fiction, Lightspeed Magazine Special Issue, The Stories. Edited by Christie Yant, Rachel Swirsky, Wendy N. Wagner, Robin Lupo, and Gabrielle DeCure. Published by John Joseph Adams. This book is read by Cassandra Campbell, Cassandra DeCure, Gabrielle DeCure, Harlan Ellison, Grover Gardner, Jamye Mary Grant, Susan Hanfield, Jonathan L. Howard, John Allen Nelson, Bahni Turpin, Stefan Rudnicki, Molly Underwood, and Judy Young.
Each to Each by Seanan McGuire. Condensation covers the walls, dimpling into tiny individual drops that follow an almost fractal pattern, like someone has been writing out the secrets of the universe in the most transitory medium they can find. The smell of damp steel assaults my nose as I walk the hall, uncomfortable boots clumping heavily with every step I force myself to take. The space is tight, confined, unyielding. It is like living inside a coral reef, trapped by the limits of our own necessary shells. We are constantly envious of those who escape its limitations, and we fear for them at the same time, wishing them safe return to the reef, where they can be kept away from all the darkness and predations of the open sea. The heartbeat of the ship follows me through the iron halls, comprised of the engine's whir, the soft, distant buzz of the electrical systems, the even more distant churn of the rudders, the hiss and sigh of the filters that keep the flooded chambers clean and oxygenated. Latest scuttlebutt from the harbor holds that a generation of wholly flooded ships is coming, ultralight fish tanks with shells of air and metal surrounding the water-filled crew chambers, the waterproofed electrical systems. Those ships will be lighter than ours could ever dream of being, freed from the need for filters and desalination pumps by leaving themselves open to the sea. None of the rumors mention the crews. What will be done to them, what they'll have to do in service to their country. We don't need to talk about it. Everyone already knows. Things that are choices today won't be choices tomorrow. That's the way it's always been. When you sign away your voice for a new means of dancing. The walkway vibrates under my feet, broadcasting the all-hands signal through the ship. It will vibrate through the underwater spaces twice more, giving everyone the time they need. Maybe that will be an advantage of those flooded boats. No more transitions. No more hasty scrambles for breathing apparatus that fits a little less well after every tour. No more forcing of feet into boots that don't really fit, but are standard issue. And standard issue is still God and King here, on a Navy vessel in the service of the United States government. Even when the sailors do not, cannot, will never fit the standard mold. I walk a little faster, as fast as I can force myself to go in my standard-issue boots, and there is only a thin shell between me and the sea. We knew that women were better suited to be submariners by the beginning of the 21st century. Women dealt better with close quarters, tight spaces, and enforced contact with the same groups of people for long periods of time. We were more equipped to resolve our differences without resorting to violence. And there were differences. Women, even military women, had been socialized to fight with words and with social snubbing. And the early all-female submarines must have looked like a cross between a psychology textbook and the Hunger Games. The military figured it out. They hired the right sociologists. They taught their people the right way to deal with conflicts and handle stress. They found ways of picking out that early programming and replacing it with fierce loyalty to the Navy, to the program, to the crew. Maybe it was one of those men, and they were all men. I've seen the records. Man after man, walking into our spaces, our submarines with their safe and narrow hulls.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.